opportunity to welcome all of you to this very beautiful moment for our parish community, a moment for which we are filled with a lot of gratitude because one of our own parishioners, one of our founding parishioners, who was so instrumental in the design and the creation of our church community here, who also designed our stained glass windows and is famous throughout the world for his wonderful artistic work, the depth and the beauty of what he has shared, Buddy Mullan. We're very honored that his wife, Celina, is with us tonight. The Stations of the Cross have been a devotion in our faith for nearly 1,000 years. Although there were various forms of them, the way that we have them now is really popularized by St. Francis of Assisi. He is the one also who brought us the nativity scene at Christmas, the Christmas creches. He wanted people to be able to experience what it meant to see the scenes of the Bible come to life. And in the 13th century, he had the opportunity to visit the Holy Land himself. But, of course, most people could not go, and most people today still cannot go. And so the way of doing pilgrimage is the way of the cross. St. Francis popularized that. And so tonight we are pleased and honored to be able to unveil these new Stations of the Cross, to take time for prayer and meditation together, and to have these stations blessed by our Archbishop at the end of the evening. It is a tradition that the Stations of the Cross, and I looked this up, Archbishop, in Canada, they have to be blessed either by a bishop or a Franciscan.
God of mercy has saved us through the death and resurrection of his own Son. The Word became flesh and emptied himself, taking the form of slave, and obediently accepting even death, death upon the cross. As we remember the measure of pouring of Christ's love, we invite it to follow the way of the cross with devout minds and hearts. Thankful to the Lord who died for us upon the cross, let us also die to sin and so walk in the newness of life. Let us pray. O God, who through your Son Jesus and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, have given us the gift of your divine mercy. Grant, we pray, that through following the way of the cross each day, we may know the depth of your love and willingly embrace sacrifice in our own lives, that we may be ambassadors of your mercy to all the world. Through the same Christ, our Lord.
I'm Pastor Lee, and I decided to become a graphic artist. I ended up over my career in the last 10 years, my short career so far, I've always been fascinated by one of her very good friends and my godfather, Jeanine, Mullan. I was always fascinated by his very subtle geometry and the way that he used interplay, gradient, and color to create the most subtle, nuanced faces and shapes in what are ultimately very simple puppets. And so it's with great pleasure tonight that I'm here to help present to you Jeanine Mullan's final work, The Stations of the Cross. Before we begin, though, I'd like to take a few minutes to introduce his work as a conceptual whole instead of piece by piece. I'm sure that most, if not all of you here tonight, are quite familiar with Flute's work. And for that reason, I think you'll find this piece quite interesting. His essential style is particularly present here, however, it's been rendered in a way that I've never actually seen from him before. But he thought that the Stations of the Cross should not be a centerpiece of a sanctuary, but rather something set aside for devotion. It's a very functional work, and while you can consider them as aesthetic objects, that really doesn't get to the core of buildings. They are a form of scripture themselves. They're representations of moments in time that are important to our faith. They allow us to walk with Christ in a pivotal moment of his life, and truly, in all our lives. He wanted these pieces to be displayed plainly, in uncomplicated gold frames. Within those frames, the borders of each piece are straightforward in nature, inspired by patterns he found in the grand frescoes he saw in St. Francis's Basilica. The simplicity is a bit of a departure from most of his work. His elaborate geometric patterns were often embellished with rich detail, yet here we find bold, uncomplicated shapes. Inside those borders, we find that he stands by what he felt was the devotional nature of the stations. They're simple images, starkly realized, that speak powerfully of the actions happening in the frame. These are not works that are meant to be contemplated independently. They're designed quite specifically to convey an emotion and lead you to your thoughts as you read about it or listen to the story that they depict. We're meant to be focused inwardly. This is also an uncharacteristically melancholy work for Bette. Appropriate, of course, for the subject matter at hand. The arched backs, pale faces, and somber realizations of the people involved here speak volumes of what's happening within the frame. Much of his work had a very particular brand of serenity to it. His modernistic style and elegantly understated details tend to evoke feelings of awe and splendor in the viewer. Yet here, however, we find a more raw quality that evokes powerful bass and movements. There's something a little different about what he has done here, and I think that we can sense just maybe a bit of conditioning of his thing. The pain that he's going through has found its way into these works. I think the Stations of the Cross is a fitting capstone to his truly impressive body of work. They're very much a story of an end, as they are the story of a new beginning. We walk with Christ in the final moments of his life, and ultimately rejoice with him when he ascends to life anew. This is a fitting tribute to Buddy's life's work, a wonderful homage to the rich history of Catholic faith. It's a tool for teaching, it's a tool for learning, and understanding our own faith. And for him alone, it's a devotion of creative labor from him to God. The Stations of the Cross consists of 14 pieces. However, I probably should note that he always intended to add 15 for this particular commission, the final being the resurrection. My mother and I joked that if he was here, he'd probably make a joke about how the resurrection wasn't his miracle. But I think more importantly, what he was trying to remind us of was that the story here does not end in the tomb. It continues on the third day, and he rose again.
Thank you, Patrick. Let's enter now with our minds and our hearts into the journey with Jesus. And I'd like to bring you now to the Garden of Gethsemane. Let us join the Lord there.
The supper was concluded. It was the last supper he would celebrate with them before his death. But they didn't understand this. They had shared the memory of their people, of how God had led them with Moses from slavery to freedom, and how they had become a people, a nation, God's own. Jesus had introduced them to a new covenant, sealed the bread and the wine. He told them that it was his body and blood, but he was sure they did not understand the meaning of it. And he was also sure that they didn't understand why he had washed their feet. 3 years together, and they understood so little. Jerusalem was crowded with pilgrims for the Passover. Many had come from places as far away as Egypt and Cyprus to celebrate and offer sacrifice. For this reason, the Romans had garrisoned additional troops, and the governor, Pontius Pilate, was staying in the city. The Romans viewed the Jews as an unruly people. Times like this required extra security. The city was noisy and unkempt. Jesus felt so distracted. He wanted a quiet place to pray. His soul was turbulent with anxiety. Judas had gone off for his assignation with the temple leaders. The other apostles were becoming sleepy. Did they have no idea what was coming? Had they no sense of urgency about the moment? How dull-witted they could be. He would lead them across the Kidron to the Mount of Olives, just outside the city. On the steep slope, there was a garden. Among the groves of olive trees, it would be quiet. They could have some privacy. The apostles were falling asleep. Father, let this cup pass from me. Did God hear his pleading? Did God know the shivering fear gripping his soul? Can you not stay awake with me 1 hour? He was frustrated with them. Did they really not know? Had all of this been in vain? Could they not sense his anguish? How much time had passed? He didn't know. The moon was rising over the mountains, but its light seemed so cold. Not my will, but yours be done. In the distance, the sound of people coming could be heard. It will be now. It all begins now.
Thank you. this station, Jesus is unjustly condemned to death by Pilate. How is this unjust? Is this not the world's cynical and expedient justice? The justice of bottom lines on spreadsheets and collateral damage in bombing campaigns. The justice of cutbacks and layoffs, of sweatshops and sex tourism. The justice that thinks not with a heart for persons, but with a cold logic for profit, for pleasure, for power. Pilate knows the world's justice and its power, for even the doubt sown by the remarkable man before him is washed away in the bowl of worldly reasonableness and the status quo. Behold the man, Pilate sneers. Behold with worldly eyes what a human person is, a cog in the machine of a great empire, an inconvenience to be aborted, a disposable object in the movement of capital and in the development of the Pax Romana. Behold the man. But wait. Is Pilate speaking of himself? Does he recognize in the wretch before him what his own humanity has become through serving the world's power and the world's prestige and the world's profit? Yes, Pilate. The man standing before you reveals what humanity is. Unbelievably, he is your humanity. Jesus is the one who stands in the mouth of a whale of a heartless world, and he is the one who stands in those like you, who are made ugly by being the hand of heartlessness. He stands with all those caught in Satan's craw of injustice and shines with a dignity and a holiness before which the rulers of this world fall silent. Behold the man. Behold the holiness of the human person. Look closely, even at the child dismissed as a fetus, the unemployed mocked as a bum, the lonely, the ignored as old maids. Behold the person. Lord, in the baptismal bowl, it is your justice that washes us clean. Your justice. Attune our eyes, O Lord, to see you standing dismissed by our world, so that when we see others, persons, we see you. Help us to behold the person.
go-getters who make things happen and who take their destiny in their own hands. What room in the world's eyes is there for those who fall by the way? For those who are made passive, forced into loneliness by being abandoned by others, forced into the indignities of a failing body by age, forced into unemployment by market forces. The world cannot bear reminders of passivity and suffering. It shuts its eyes, or worse, holds up for ridicule those who cannot take their destiny in their hands. The Creator of heaven and earth, whose hands formed from dust woman and man, in whose hands lies destiny itself, takes up what? The cross which others have fashioned. The cross of ridicule and fear and blindness. The cross whose wood is made from favelas and ghettos and killing fields. The cross fashioned by sin is taken by the Lord of all ages for his destiny, so that all who are crucified might share his lordship in eternal glory.
It is an appallingly lonely sound.
bitter, broken thought that drags us down, down, down into the dust. And there he is, the one who made us from the dust. The one who wrote in the dust to remind a howling mob of a sinner's humanity. He is in the dust that settles like ash around our ears after our fall. There he is. Adam and Eve heard the sound of the Lord God walking and were afraid. We, the children of Adam and Eve, hear the sound of the Lord God falling and are afraid no more. He is here, even here in the dust. He is here with us. Is this so? Will we allow him to be with us? Will we walk with him once again in the garden?
Of so many mothers. Even here you go, Lord Jesus. You go even to the place where so many who cause untold heartaches to their mothers are standing. When it costs you both, Jesus and Mary. You who would sit together in the evening light of Nazareth. You, Mary, what a cost to be one with all whose hearts break in the suffering of a loved one, of a child. You, Jesus, what a cost to be one with those caught in the sin's web and who occasion such suffering. Mary knew a sword would pierce her soul. But such a sword? The sword of being one with the Son made flesh in her? In her amen, in the suffering of his being made sin by his amen. Crown of thorns will be lifted from his head and placed, transformed into a diadem of stars upon your brow, O Queen of Heaven. Imagine that, a mother's suffering, your crown of thorns transformed into a diet of stars with you in love. That meeting in Jerusalem was the forge that fashioned that crown. It fashions yours. It is a crown promised us, O God, your children.
It is heavy, Simon. for it is the weight of your own sin, of my sin. Half the world's people, nearly 3 billion persons, live in countries where the annual per capita income is $400 or less. At least 1 billion persons live in absolute poverty, that is, beneath any rational definition of human decency. Nearly 8 million are chronically hungry, despite abundant harvests worldwide. 17 out of 100 children born in those countries die before the age of 5. And millions of the survivors are physically and mentally stunted. What inconvenience this injustice. What hard work to undo it. And to what end? More of the same, year after year. Our crosses are hard enough, so why shoulder the cross of another? Jesus is one with those unmade by sin for stunted lives. The cross of another. It is heavy, my brothers and sisters, for it is the weight of my sins, of our sins.
Who will remake you into glory beyond glory. glory. Beauty beyond beauty. Good beyond goodness. Already, the ill logic of sin is undone from within. To reach out to wipe the face of the brother or sister smashed by sin and neglect is to reach out to the image of the Lord God, which shines in every agony, even in mourning. Why are you doing this? The dying man asked the woman cleaning his dying flesh. Because you are Christ, my brother, and I love you, replied Teresa of Calcutta.
But the voice of the true shepherd
us from the dust. Speaks? No. Not speaks. Sings softly and gently. Found in the dust. We are raised to our feet, the voice echoing in our hearts. Found and lovely. And worthy. And lovable. Found in our sin, we walk from the confessional, the voice singing, found and lovely and worthy.
Disconsolate, but protesting. not bereft of direction and meaning, but purposeful. Not enslaved, but free. Days of struggle are coming, but the barriers of the city of Jerusalem, with its narrow streets and Roman occupiers, give way to Golgotha, and the mountains where all will be new, and the shuffling cries of pain become the dancing shouts of victory.
Breath of God.
We came naked into this world, and we leave naked. Ashes to ashes. We have nothing. This is the truth. Our sin leaves us standing in this truth even more vulnerably. Youth lost leaves us lost when body and mind fail. Seeking for self-fulfillment leaves the gaping hole of broken relationships. Fortunes amassed leave the calloused fear of those who rely on the work of their hands, not on the work of their money. They are not. To be naked before this truth, before everyone, is unbearable. It is the lot of the criminal condemned to prison, the adulterer discovered, the corrupt revealed, the liar found out. He became naked, not before the beautiful ease of Adam and Eve's original natural gaze, but before the shame-filled prurience of undistorted eyes. And he was made vulnerable to sinners, left open to the leering, the jeering, the whispering, the gossiping, the angry eyes. Left open also to the eyes of his mother. Did she long to wrap him again in swaddling clothes? Left open to the eyes of his disciples. Left open to our eyes. To turn away our face in shame. For here is seen our great fear, and that is shame. He is here, even here. But look again, most vulnerable. He is most noble. Dignity is here, dwelling even here. Clothing did not make the man, no. He pulses with divinity and life. Behold the man. Behold clearly the man. Behold what God has done. Walk with us to the shame-filled nakedness that was the first distortion of sin, so that we could walk in him to a new nature, clothed in him who is purity and light and beauty. Behold clearly the Christ. For he stands vulnerable before us with his supreme openness. He stands vulnerable before us with his supreme love. Be not afraid. Be open to God. Be open to love.
Tears are
station, Jesus is nailed to the cross. He is fixed before the world. His crucified body is the image of sin and shame. So that you can dance in his righteousness. What a glorious exchange. We give him a cross, and he opens for us heaven's eternity. The echo of hammer blows, the echo of our hurts and pains, our tears and frustrations, the echo of our injustice and violence that sounds again and again in this world, is now filled with the glory of the final trumpet. For this is death's hour, its last hour. It is no more. Sin's sting is drawn by the nails that pierce life's hands. Sin is seen broken on the cross, and forgiveness reigns.
Holy God, holy mighty
Holy God, Holy Mighty One, Holy Immortal One, have mercy on us. Holy God, Holy Mighty One, Holy Immortal One, have mercy on us.
Still, for the breast upon which he lay moves no more. Are there words enough to fill this empty vessel? My condolences at your loss. As good as ever. Magdalene, used and abandoned by many men, now is left by the man who opened for her, yes, to her dignity. Are there words enough to fill this empty vessel? My deepest regrets, as good as any. The silent group is played out again and again in the world on this side of the victory. In hospital rooms, mortuary pages, in deepest families, at gravesides, this silent group huddled together. In loss, met again and again. But now a new word is spoken. The empty vessels of death and loss are filled with this new word. The best of words. The perfect word. Perfect. The only word. This is the cup of my love. The new poured out for you. For you. And you. And you. The word became God's lifeblood that we drink, and which flows in our hearts with hope, with joy.
Silent. Hardly. for the body that was dead is risen. And into the hearts, hardened by sin into rock, is hewn not a tomb, but a tabernacle. Behold, the tomb has become tabernacle, resounding with new words to fill the silence. Take and eat. This is my body given up for you. The rock pulses with life, for sin is transformed into forgiveness. He has lain down in the tomb of our sin so that our hearts might be the tabernacle of his glory. Behold what our God has wrought with our sin. Behold what God has done in us. In Christ Jesus, we are God's righteousness. No more are we to lie in the lifelessness of sin. We are to feed the world with what we have become, the tabernacle of Christ, open to feed all with the taste of justice, peace, and joy.
Traced with us our pilgrim walk on earth. so that we may join forever in the circling dance that is the eternal life of Father, Son, and Spirit. Death no longer reigns in our hearts, for the cross, death, was embraced by God, so that life might embrace and transform us. Yes, we are dead. Dead to sin. Dead to injustice. Dead to death itself. For I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Upside down, our hearts are right side up. Our death was Christ's own. Now, Christ's righteousness is our own. Christ is risen from the dead, trampling down death by death. And on those in the tombs, bestowing life.
Was brought to death and raised to the dead, in order that we might die to sin and live lives in holiness. By the favor and blessing, draw near with mercy to your faithful people, who devoutly recall the mysteries of Christ's passion. Grant that those who follow us put footsteps in the bearing their cross patiently, may we see, as the word, the vision of Christ in his glory. For he lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
Through the cross and blood of his Son, has given us a gift of redemption and salvation, saying his blessing upon you.
Amen.
May God grant that with all his saints you may grasp fully the breadth, length, height, and depth of the cross of Christ.
Amen.
May God in his mercy look kindly upon you as you walk the way of the cross and listen compassionately to your prayers.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, I don't know about you, but my heart is just moved and full of gratitude at this time. And I want to thank Buddy Mullan, who is, we hope and we believe, enjoying the communion of the saints right now. Thank you, Buddy, for your great gift to us. A very special thanks to Celina, who saw this project through to its completion with a very full heart. Celina, thank you so much, and God bless you.
Helene and Patrick and our musicians and singers tonight who have helped us to pray. Pray from the very depths of our hearts. Thank you so very kindly for being here on Friday night. We appreciate that. And finally, a very special thanks to our Archbishop, who has been, I don't know how you came up with your schedule, but you've had to be all over the state of Texas this week as our metropolitan bishop, and is actually leaving very shortly to be with Pope Francis in Mexico. We'll be with him at the Mass in Juarez and El Paso. Archbishop, thank you for being with us tonight. Thank you for blessing us.
I'm working with Charles.